Welcome to Men of the Heart, a monthly podcast from the Archdiocese of Detroit Office of Priestly Vocations. Join me, your host, Father David Pellican, and generally, our fearless leader and also host, Father Craig Gira, as we explore the priesthood, hear vocation stories from priests all over the Archdiocese, and answer questions about discerning a priestly vocation. Tune in every month to wherever you get your podcasts. Learn more at DetroitPriestlyVocations.com. Well, welcome, listeners, to another episode of Men of the Heart. Last episode, I was not here. I was out. As Father Craig said, someone made me an offer I couldn't refuse. So I was absent, but it was a beautiful episode where Father John Copson shared his vocation story and kind of the ins and outs of discerning into seminary, discerning back out, and then re-entering and becoming a priest. Today we have another wonderful guest with us. I'd like to welcome Bishop Robert Fisher. Bishop Fisher was ordained a priest in 1992, and he served in a variety of positions around the Archdiocese, including Shrine of the Little Flower. And Bishop, I believe you were also vocations director for a little while, is that right?
I was. That was my second assignment as a priest. I was an associate pastor first and then the vocation office for 5 years.
Well, welcome. It's very good to have you here. Looking forward to hearing a little bit about your story and anything you might share with young men who are discerning a call.
I'm glad to do that today. You know, in thinking back over my call to the priesthood, I at first thought of kind of some larger moments, but then looking back again, realized that there were some smaller moments much earlier on that certainly contributed to my finding my way to the seminary and then to ordination. I'm one of four kids. I'm the oldest of the four. My parents and my brothers and sister, I should say my sisters and brother, we grew up originally on the west side of Detroit, not too far from Sacred Heart Major Seminary, about 3 miles down the road, in fact.
Oh, really?
And then we moved to Southfield later on. So we started off our time in Epiphany Parish and then later on in St. Bede Parish, both of which are of happy memory right now. Mm-hmm. But both of those places do play a role in my call to the priesthood. I can remember as a child, really, I was probably about 9 or 10 years old, down the block from us was the family, the Matuzik family, and one of their sons was in the seminary. And Mrs. Matuzik invited me to come to see one of the plays here at the seminary.
Oh, sure.
And so I can remember walking in the door, and they had these great big lilac bushes there. They were really, really wonderfully scented. But going in and seeing the play and being very impressed by, you know, the seminary building itself. I also think back to those childhood years, and my mom had three sisters, and at one time all three of them were in the convent. One of them discerned out, but the other two discerned that this was their calling in life and stayed on and were part of the Immaculate Heart of Mary community and served as teachers and all different kinds of roles throughout our archdiocese and other dioceses. I also had a great uncle who was a priest. He was a founding pastor of Christ the Good Shepherd in Lincoln Park, Father Joseph Torzeski. He had a cousin whom I did not know because he had died back in the 1940s, but he was also a bishop, and that was Bishop Joseph Ploggins. He would have been the second auxiliary bishop we had in the Archdiocese of Detroit, and then later became the Bishop of Marquette. And then later on, the Bishop of Grand Rapids, which is where he passed away very young, in his 60s. In my family, anyways, there certainly was precedence for, you know, a religious vocation, and not just precedence. More importantly, there was I guess I'd call it a supportive attitude, yeah, you know, that's towards somebody discerning a call, you know, towards priesthood and religious life.
Would you say the faith was pretty strongly practiced growing up among your family and your siblings? I mean, did you guys go to Mass every Sunday?
Yeah, we really did. Okay. It was part of our normal family practice, and I can remember even going on family vacations, and we'd go camping in, you know, parts of Canada, and not necessarily near a big city, and that was always a priority, was to find out when Mass was and to attend Mass. My parents set a great example that way, and certainly going to Mass, but also just being active in our parish community.
Sure.
I can remember throughout childhood, if there was something that was needed around the church, my dad would often get tapped, would you help out with this? And he would say yes, and then he dragged me along with him.
Oh, sure. Yep. A little extra muscle, right?
Right.
Did you ever altar serve growing up? Was that ever part of?
Yeah, I did. I did first at Epiphany and then at St. Bede in Southfield. And it was right after the council. And so kind of interesting trying to learn how to be an altar server, because at Epiphany in Detroit, they didn't quite know what was going to happen. So they said, well, I guess you should memorize the Latin prayers, but we're not sure that you're going to use them.
And, oh, wow.
And that was kind of the way the whole altar server training went, is that it may be different, but this is how we're doing it now, kind of thing.
Wow.
So
I altar served a bit growing up too, and I really, really loved that. I think it forced me as a young boy to really pay attention at Mass, because, you know, you don't want to miss your cue. You mentioned around 10. Is that when you first started thinking about the priesthood?
Yeah, I would say it was in those years. In fact, I used to play priest, my sisters at the time be the congregation, and we had Mass in the basement, you know, using all the things that, you know, you use, whether it was the Necco wafers for the host, finding a plastic chalice or something that looked like a chalice, and on and on, and getting my mom to make me some vestments. So,
wow.
So I did do that for a couple of years in childhood. Yeah.
Oh, that's very nice. We did similar things as children. I have all sisters.
Two sisters, one brother.
Two sisters, one brother. My sisters would be my altar servers in my congregation as well. I never had vestments made for me though. So did that call kind of stick with you? Were there times of doubt, or was that pretty much just you knew it and you were going with that path?
It did. I guess I'd say I laid it aside during high school years. I was still very touched by opportunities to serve and to be involved, but not necessarily in ordained ministry. You know, my focus kind of changed, I guess I would say. I was very involved with the music program at our parish and that kind of thing. I really enjoy singing and that, but really set aside the call to priesthood. But at the same time, had some wonderful witnesses of good parish priests. I can remember one priest that we had. I was very involved in the Boy Scout program. It was a brand new priest, came to the parish, and every time we went on a camp out, he made a real effort to be out there for the Saturday evening Mass. And I still have pictures of one of our gear boxes covered with a green ground cloth, and then on it, two Coleman lanterns on each corner as our altar. But he would come out and
have masses
for us. And then just go back home. But I remember being very, very touched, very impressed by the fact that he would do that for us.
Mm-hmm.
So, and we also had other wonderful associate pastors at our parish, you know, and they'd get us involved in projects, you know, that needed to be done around the church. And they were fine guys. It left a positive impression, despite the fact that I was really starting to think, you know, I think I'm called to marriage. I'm called to do something in business or something. So
I think those are pretty natural thoughts for someone in high school. So what did you do after high school then? You graduated. Did you go to college somewhere?
Yep, I graduated from U of D Jesuit, and after that, it was a wonderful experience there, great being with the Jesuits. I went for 1 year to the University of Michigan, thinking that, you know, I wanted to get into business in some way. I went there, but it just was not a good match for me. It was a huge, huge place, as we all know, and just I found it to be a little overwhelming.
Sure.
And so after that year, I transferred to the University of Detroit. I did the rest of my college there, but what I was studying was business and computers, and again, it was one of those transitional times. We started out learning how to program using punch cards, and then slowly, you know, we moved to the cathode ray tube terminals where you could actually type in your program line by line. But it was a big change, and one of the things I remember from that time was being afraid to get stuck behind a math major in the computer lab who would have decks of cards that were 3 foot wide, and, you know, ours were, you know, 4, 5, 6 inches wide, you know, and it would go on and on as the printer tried to keep up with it. But that was my thought at that point, was I really wanted to, get into business. I saw myself as being a husband and a father and having a white picket fence and a dog in the yard and living happily ever after.
Nice. So you had an image for the future, a plan.
Yeah, I did.
If you don't mind me asking, what was your prayer life relationship with the Lord like in college? Did you find it was pretty strong, waned a little bit?
It was probably a little back and forth. I would say in terms of getting to Mass, there were a group of us that in my dorm, we were all Catholic, and we supported each other in that. And,
oh, that's awesome.
And got each other to go and make sure we went to Mass each week. And,
wow.
And that was a good group. Yes, it was. It was truly, truly a blessing. And then once I transferred to University of Detroit, got back involved again in my home parish. So certainly in terms of weekly Mass, that was always a priority. Mm-hmm. And I guess over time then, little by little, personal prayer life, started to grow more deeply too. Mm-hmm.
What did you find was, in terms of personal prayer, what kind of attracted you or drew you most to that? I mean, was it praying the rosary? Was it just quiet time?
Yeah, probably my favorite way to pray then and still is now is just kind of some quiet time in front of the Blessed Sacrament.
Yeah. Amen.
I can remember, well, and we'll get to another part of the story in a little bit, but where that really became significant for me.
Okay. So you're going through college. You've got this plan kind of for your life, what your future might look like. Priesthood was just kind of out of the picture then. Was it still in the back of your mind? What changed that obviously...
Yeah, something did change, yeah. right? During my summers in college, one of the adult leaders in my Boy Scout troop had been after me to come work at a summer camp. And for me, it was the CYO Boys Camp up near Port Sanilac, Michigan. Okay. And he had been after me for a couple years to come and do this. And I kept saying to him, I can't. I said, if I do that, I won't have enough money to pay for my gas to get to school, let alone anything else. But yes. But I finally said yes to him, and it was probably as much to get him off my back as it was anything else. But I did. I worked for a summer and was a assistant unit leader. Was one of the a counselor, but with some responsibility for leading the other counselors, kind of thing.
Yeah.
And I have to say, I had met some seminarians in the past. And I'd met a couple this summer, and I found them to be rather dry. They just didn't have a whole lot of excitement or enthusiasm until I met one particular seminarian whom we've been talking a lot about here the last couple of weeks in our archdiocese, and that's Archbishop Paul Russell.
Oh, wow.
He was a seminarian for the Archdiocese of Boston at that time, and this was a first summer at camp for both of us. And along with a third counselor who was there, now Father Ed Zaworski. Ed and I, neither of us were in the seminary at that time, but then Paul Russell was. And so as I watched Paul, it really sparked something very deep in me. He was a man who was good with kids. He was good with people. He was very friendly, very outgoing. He knew how to have a wonderful time. And he was a man of great prayer. And I was just really touched by that example. I referred to something before that started to play a role in my own discernment, and that was we had a chapel at our camp, and it was kind of off in a corner away from things. I found myself over the course of years spending more and more time there. I have to say that one summer at summer camp, ended up being 8 summers altogether. And even after I graduated from college, I wanted to stay on because I was really moved by working with people in a faith setting and working with other people who thought faith was important and were trying to live it out. So it was in the course of that time that the call to priesthood, came back to me.
Actually, as we're sitting here, the audience can't see, but I feel woefully underdressed, and that's actually because I'm just getting back from a summer camp. I was up for a week at Camp Santa Maria up north, and so can relate to that, just that fondness for really wanting to serve others. And I think, you know, you could probably speak to this as well, but it's just so edifying to see the change that takes place in the kids over the week or 2 weeks that they're there. You know, they often get there, especially these days, you know, maybe not even knowing how to have like a conversation with someone away from their phone and technology, you know, and you just watch them forge these friendships as they're, you know, just doing fun stuff outside, you know, and it's just so edifying for me. I was, as a seminarian, I was a counselor up there for a couple summers, I think 4 summers, so about half your time.
Yeah.
But really loved it and just really... I was even reflecting as I was up there. I think that might have been the single most like formative experience for the way I, you know, am a priest today. You know, it taught me how to like, you know, as I came right out of high school, as a lot of our listeners know, and so just to be responsible for all these young men, you know, and really to just want to like love them, give them what's best for them. Like it was awesome for me too as a counselor. So I'm sure you can relate. Did staying there for 8 years, you must have served in a variety of roles as well. Did you take on some, obviously you said you weren't just a counselor, but helping the other counselors. Did you have like an area that you really loved particularly about camp or a role that you had that you really enjoyed?
You know, I think every job at camp is enjoyable in its own way.
Amen.
You know, probably some more than others. Certainly being a cabin counselor, one of the joys is you can just see in the eyes of the kids how they look up to the counselors.
Mm-hmm.
And you recognize what an incredible opportunity it is to touch their hearts,
yes,
you know, with something good. And so that was always the best job at camp, and I didn't often get to do that, but there were times where I did get to be in a cabin with a group of kids. But I became the camp director a couple summers later.
Oh, wow.
And then did that for the rest of my my time at camp. And so it's then you realize that, you know, even though administration can be a little bit dry, it does provide a structure so that the rest of the wonderful things can happen, you know, at camp.
I'm sure you became a bit of a counselor to the counselors in some ways. Too,
exactly.
As in that role. So, yeah, I was just so thankful to come back. And just what you said about the impact you can have on kids as a counselor. I've been away from there for about 6 years since I was a counselor there. So coming back, a good chunk of the counselors now were campers who I had in cabin, which was really cool to see. It's also a little alarming because I see them and I'm just kind of hardwired to say they can't be trusted with anything, you know, and now they're in charge of all these kids. But it's beautiful just to see how much they'd grown since I'd last been there and how much they kind of still loved camp and wanted to give back in the ways that they had kind of received when they were kids. So that's beautiful. And you said it was at camp that you kind of this call to the priesthood came back. What was that like? Did you hear a voice? Was it a dramatic kind of moment, or was it?
I can't say it was a dramatic moment, a voice, anything like that. But it was just more of a sense that I needed to look into that, and you know, so I began to pray about it, and I talked to Father Ed Zorsky about it, as well as Paul Russell, now Archbishop Russell, and what started as just a mere friendship began mutual support for each other as we, you know, as Paul continued to discern his time in the seminary, as well as Father Ed and myself hearing the call for the first time.
Wow.
So I wrestled with it because in the back of my mind was still that image of the white picket fence and a family and a
the
wife.
The dog in the front yard.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Yep.
So, you know, but I started to pray about that. And as I did, I just had a sense from God saying, you may not see it now, but I think it would be good for you to at least try the seminary. Go to the seminary for a year, apply, and if you're accepted, go to the seminary, and then let's talk some more about it. So I did. I applied, and it took me a couple years of the live-in, the discernment weekends, and all that before actually getting in. But did make the application, was accepted. It very much was at the end of those first years in seminary. It was kind of, you know, the thing where I'd say to the Lord, you know, Lord, this was a great year. Mm-hmm. I learned a lot about my faith. I learned a lot about myself. I feel my relationship is deepening with you. But what about those kids and the white fence and the dog?
Yeah, yeah. But I think there's something beautiful about the freedom in knowing that coming to seminary doesn't necessarily mean you've got it all figured out or have absolute clarity. That a big part of what we do in seminary is discern that call. You know, in an environment that's really really helpful to that, with plenty of prayer and priests and spiritual directors to talk to. You came in without absolute clarity, but you were willing to give it a shot.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. That's exactly the way it was. And so each of those years would go by, and I'd end up in that same conversation with the Lord until the program was a little different then. We had 1 year of, if you had your degree already, mm-hmm. you had 1 degree, 1 year of philosophy, and then 5 years of theology.
Okay.
And year three of theology at that time was a full year in the parish. It was during that experience where you're actually living the life of a priest as closely as you can be without actually being one.
Right.
That I just knew that this is what God wanted me to do. And, you know, felt it confirmed in my prayer. And yet I still pushed the Lord a little bit and said, but I still would like to be, I still like to have my own kids, you know, I'd still like to, you know, that. And, but I just had a sense from the Lord that we're going to take care of that. Don't worry about it. Mm. We're going to take care of that. Mm-hmm. And so I did push on and, you know, was ordained in 1992. And on that issue of kids, really the way the Lord has fulfilled that in my heart is you come to realize as a parish priest that the children of the parish are your children.
Mm.
You're their spiritual father.
Amen.
You know, and I certainly have looked to them, you know, in the three assignments I had as a pastor and the one as an associate pastor. I very much looked at them as being my spiritual children, and often get called on now to do their weddings and that, which is just a great joy for me to
absolutely.
Do. It's a great joy.
That's
and then,
beautiful.
And the other part of it too that I think really that has been a gift from God is that through my siblings, I've got two nieces and two nephews, and so I really like to look at them as being my own kids in mm-hmm. a way. And so, you know, when they were younger, my sisters would get mad and I'd come over, and along with my brother, we'd wind them up, have all kinds of fun, and then say, see ya.
Bye. Don't have to deal with them at night. Yeah.
Oh, by the way, have some sugar before you go to bed.
Yes, that is so true, though, and it's such a blessing. I just, two of my sisters have gotten married in the last maybe 3-4 years. So there's two nephews and a niece now, all very young. And
yeah.
So I can relate to that a little bit, going over, having a great time with them, giving them some candy, and then you're out of there.
Yeah. You know?
But it's beautiful.
Just before that last diaper change.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Well, you said you got a lot of clarity on this year away, and that's not kind of like part of the normal, you could say, if you want to call it that, process right now in seminary, although some of that might be changing soon. But I know a lot of guys who were started out with me or ended up with me who took that year, just like a pastoral year in a parish, just of their own will, and really loved it and said it was so good. And they would come back to seminary kind of with this renewed sense of purpose, like, this is why we're doing what we're doing here. What parish were you at for that year?
I was at St. Malachy in Sterling Heights.
Okay, very good. And was there a moment in that where you kind of had this clarity? Was it something that came more gradually?
Yeah, I'd have to say it really came more gradually. But I just knew that I loved all the things that I was doing, and I could really see myself, you know, living in a parish and doing these kinds of things for the rest of my life.
Yeah. The reason I ask it is we hear a lot of vocation stories. It's one of the graces of co-hosting this podcast. And you just see the whole range of how God calls people.
Mm.
You know, some people have these very clear moments. You know, like Father John Copson was on last time, and he literally had this, you could call it just like incredibly miraculous moment that finally sealed the deal that he was called to be a priest. And then other people, it is, like you said, it's very gradual, kind of just like this sense of the Lord gradually drawing you deeper, and there's no maybe heaven's opening moments. And it's just, I guess it's a testament to the Lord. You know, he knows us very well, and he speaks to us each kind of uniquely in the way that suits us best.
Yeah,
that's beautiful.
Yeah, the priest I was with on that internship year, Father Gerald Britz, a wonderful man, kind of a gruff exterior at times, But a heart of absolute gold. Mm. Just would, you know, he'd do anything for anybody. And he was later in his priesthood when I met him. And just to see his commitment to continuing to deepen his spiritual life, as well as his continual reading about our faith and learning more about our faith. Again, it was one of those examples that you know, just really touched me. And was a powerful witness for me.
How did you like your time at seminary? I know some guys absolutely love it. Others maybe struggle a little with certain aspects of it. What was that like for you, that experience of seminary?
You know, I loved the community aspect of it. Of course, it was often, we would say back then, that's the best and worst parts of seminary is the community.
Sure.
You know, in both directions.
Of course.
You know, you love your brothers, but sometimes you get frustrated with them.
Like family, right?
Yeah, exactly. Just like family. But no, I really did enjoy seminary time. But I have to say, though, after being in that internship experience, it's like I could feel myself wanting to flap my wings, you know, more and more. And was looking forward to finishing seminary. Although I have to say, too, though, that coming back to the seminary after that internship year really gave me a whole new way of looking at studies, you know, and there was a kind of motivation that came with it, you know, to really want to delve into things. And I could hear myself saying all the time, let's see, this is how I could use this in the parish. This is how I could use that in the parish, that kind of thing. So
that's beautiful. And I think there's something healthy about a certain sense of wanting to flap your wings, as you said. You know, it's I can definitely relate to that. You know, towards the end, just being ready to get out there. And, you know, there's a sense in which, you know, seminary is great, but God didn't call me to be a seminarian, you know? And it's like my vocation, and I felt that once I became a priest, was like, now I'm really living the purpose that God created me for. Mm-hmm. And there was something just like really energizing about that. And you felt like I've made it kind of, you know? So yeah, I can certainly see how that would be the case. So what was priesthood like for you? I mean, I'm 2 years out now, not quite a baby priest anymore, but what were those first couple of years like as a priest?
Well, as you know firsthand, Father David, it's all about doing your firsts and learning, you know, those
lots of learning, lots of learning.
All the practical aspects, you know, of being a parish priest. And it was really wonderful to see how people in the parish, my first assignment was at Our Lady Star of the Sea on the east side.
Oh, sure.
And just to see how people were there, they wanted to see you succeed. Even if you goofed up with something, they, you know, you could do this. And they were just very, very encouraging and very, very supportive. And that's really a blessing that we shouldn't overlook, that, you know, the people of God want to see their priests succeed. They really, they you know, they love their priests, you know.
And, they do.
And want to see that happen. And I very much felt that, you know, in those first years of priesthood.
Yeah, no, I always say the toughest crowd I ever preached to was my brother seminarians in preaching practicum. You know, it's
indeed.
You get out there.
I'm sure you've had one of those invitations to come back to the seminary after being ordained.
Right? Yes,
and then
yes.
Having to preach to them.
Same mass. And,
exactly.
Yeah, that was, honestly, I was ordained in the middle of the pandemic, right?
Oh.
So I didn't come, I came back and did one, but I was actually 2 years out. And, you know,
you're
a little more confident.
Right.
But there is something. I was a little nervous, you know, getting up there. And well, it was just like, this is the chapel I spent so many hours, you know, praying in, discerning in as a seminarian. And those are all my formators lined up in the stalls, you know, right around me as I'm saying Mass. So
ready to take notes.
Yeah. See how they did, I guess, informing me. But it was beautiful, but it was definitely a little on the edge of your seat for that one.
So. Mm-hmm.
How long were you vocations director for? What was that like?
5 years for that.
Oh, wow.
Yep. Yeah, so after completing my first 3 years, Cardinal Maida, our archbishop at the time, asked me to do that work. And I really, you know, love the priesthood and, you know, had guided a couple of retreats for seminarians. And the part that was challenging, of course, was being out of the parish because I'd just, you know, fallen in love with being in a parish, you know. And but at the same time, it was a real privilege to witness the Holy Spirit touching a man's heart and trying to help him discern this call that, you know, I had fairly recently gone through myself. And, but yeah, just a real privilege to see God touching a man's heart and saying, you know, I want you to consider this, and trying to help them do that in a very constructive way.
That is a privilege. As you know, Father Craig lives with us at Divine Child, so I get to hear a little bit about just kind of the joys and struggles of being a vocations director. And I think that's definitely something he misses too at times, is being in the parish, kind of having that day-to-day just interaction with the people of God, ministering to them, all the sacraments. So it is a bit of a sacrifice, I get the sense, to be the vocations director and not have that in as regular of a way. You know, we had Bishop Hanchin in here a couple months ago, and he was vocations director for a little bit as well.
He was my vocation director.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Small world.
Yeah.
But he was talking about just how different it was when he was vocations director, that he didn't really go out and try to recruit at all. People just came to him. What was your experience of vocations when you were a director?
Yeah, well, I was out on the road a lot, visiting schools as well as helping out in different parishes on the weekends and trying to have every homily end up in some way, you know.
Yeah.
That reminds me.
Yeah.
Have you ever thought about being a priest or a religious sister or brother, you know?
Mm.
So, yeah, we did a lot of that. We also did those programs where we were inviting the seventh graders to come down to the seminary and have a chance to see the building here and have an experience of the seminarians and join in for Mass and for lunch and then talk a little bit about vocations, too.
I gave a lot of tours to junior high students in my 8 years here, so.
Yes. There was a lot of pizza and a lot of hot dogs that went out of this building.
Well, you probably don't remember this because you're probably mine was in a very different place. But when you were ordained a bishop, along with Bishop Batterby, I was a seminarian at that time. I served for the ordination.
Oh, okay.
So got to see that up close and personal. And I'm sure being vocations director was a change vocationally for you personally. What was it like getting ordained a bishop, getting that call? What was that like for you?
Yeah, it was, overwhelming, completely surprising, not having any idea where this came from. And the story I often tell is I was pastor at the Shrine in Royal Oak at the time, and I had been meeting with my associate pastors that morning, Father Patrick Gagno and Father Ryan Adams.
Oh, yes.
So we had meetings that morning, and while we were meeting, my phone was on the table upside down. And well, I should back up to the day before. I'd gotten a call that I just assumed was a robocall.
Sure.
You know, I didn't recognize the phone number, and it was an area code from out of the area.
Yeah.
So that's what I thought it was for sure. So I said, just let it go to voicemail. We'll see what it is. So that was the day before. Then this day when I had the meetings with Father Patrick, Father Ryan, I had my phone on the table. And while we were meeting, the phone was buzzing a lot, more than it normally would. So finally, when we were done, I turned the phone over, and there were a couple calls from that number again, that strange number, but again, no message.
Okay.
But then there was a text, and the text said, "This is the Archbishop. Call me on my cell number as soon as you can." Then there was a text from Father Steve Pullis, who was a secretary at the time, saying, "You need to call the Archbishop on his cell phone at this number right away." I'm thinking, on his cell phone, nobody gets that number, you know. So I did, and first thing Archbishop says to me is, "Father, you're hard to get a hold of." I'm thinking to myself, "Archbishop, I got your text. I called you. What more do you want?"
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
And he says, "I'm here at the bishop's meeting in Baltimore. One of my confreres needs to speak to you." I'm saying to myself,
"Yeah.
One of your confreres needs to speak to me about what?" And so he says, "Call this number and then call me back." Didn't tell me who I was calling or anything.
Yeah.
So he gives me the number. Well, it was that mystery number that kept appearing on my phone.
Uh-huh.
So I called the number, and person answered on the other end. And I said, "This is Father Robert Fisher. Archbishop Vigneron asked me to give you a call." So the voice on the other end of the line said, "This is Archbishop Christophe Pierre. I'm the papal nuncio to the United States of America. The Holy Father, Pope Francis, wants you to be auxiliary bishop in Detroit. Do you accept?"
Wow.
So I about fell off my chair, of course.
Not much of an intro.
No,
just
no,
right
no,
to the
no
point,
intro.
Huh?
Just, yeah. He's afraid he wouldn't get me again, yeah. I think. In talking to some of the new bishops later that year, they at least had the presence of mind to say, well, can I pray about it and call you back? Mm-hmm. I was just dumbfounded, and I was kind of tongue-tied, but I said to him, yes, yeah. I'll do it. So then I called Archbishop back, and he says, well, what did you say? And I said, I told him yes. And he says, yeah. Oh, well, very good. He says, by the way, you have a twin. Father Gerard Battersby is also going to be ordained an auxiliary bishop for Detroit.
Wow.
So,
that must have been quite the shock. And now, correct me if I'm wrong, but you don't tell anyone that right away.
Yeah, you're not allowed to tell anyone.
Okay,
you know, outside of your spiritual director, your confessor,
yep.
you're not allowed to tell anyone. So this was November 15th is when I got the call, and so it was that following weekend was going to be Synod 16.
Oh, wow.
And so Archbishop says, I want you to be there for at least a part of it. And I had a bunch of activities at the parish. It was hard to get away, but I did go to it, but couldn't say anything to anybody about it.
Was that difficult?
It was very difficult. Although I could talk to Bishop Battersby, or we could talk about it.
Yeah.
And it was funny because he was saying that Archbishop Burns had said to him, he says, well, you know how there's the funeral preface that says, Lord, for your people,
it's
changed,
yeah.
not ended.
Changed, says, not ended, yeah.
No, yeah, it's changed and ended for you as a bishop.
That's so funny. Yeah. That's funny. You know, I only found this out a while later, but when Bishop Battersby got the call, Father Battersby, he was at the seminary. He was my formator at the time. Mm. And we had a formation meeting scheduled for later that day. And I thought it was strange because I went in. He was kind of like, how are things going? You know, and I said, good, good. And he goes, good? Everything's good? Good. He goes, I think we're all set. And that was it.
The
that
shortest
was the
meeting. Formation
yeah.
meeting in history, right?
So I think he had other things on his mind because I found out later that I think it was that morning that he'd gotten the call.
Okay.
So
yeah.
Wow. That's wild. And how's it been being a bishop? I mean, I know that's a big question, but.
Yeah. You know, I'll often say to parishioners that where I was once pastor, I said, you know, it's bittersweet. Mm-hmm. Bitter in the sense of, you know, I do miss parish life. I miss being, you know, in there with the families and getting to know the kids and watching them grow and all that kind of thing. But on the other hand, as a bishop, you know, you get to see a whole different side of the church and get to do some pretty neat things, you know, all in the name of trying to make sure that the faith is passed on. So it's both, you know, it's got its joys, it's got its sorrows, both, you know.
Sure. So yeah, I know it was even just watching the ceremony of ordination to become a bishop was very striking for me. And I, as the book bearer, I kind of got a up-close look. Mm. But there was just so much stuff that I don't even know if I understood, just like holding the book open above your head or something at some point.
Right,
and
right.
then your whole head got anointed with chrism.
Did it ever. The Archbishop was very generous with the use of the chrism, yes.
but it was a beautiful, beautiful rite, as all ordinations are. And yeah, we're very, very glad, of course, to have you as a bishop. Speaking of that, you mentioned Archbishop Russell, and I know there's been, you know, a lot of chatter going on with him coming back here as auxiliary bishop to serve alongside you. Can you explain, if you can, how does someone become an archbishop and an auxiliary bishop all at once?
If you can explain the workings of the Holy Spirit, you've got your next book ready to write, you know. It's, you know, being in diplomatic service is can be really a challenge for a man. And again, you know, I've known Archbishop Russell all these years, and I know that it's hard to be away from family and friends and you know, in a great way. You're really far away. It's not just, you know, you're a couple hours away, but you're several hours away. And some of those assignments can be very intense, very, very intense. Mm-hmm. So I think in Archbishop's own discernments, you know, it was time to try and do something just a little bit different within the church.
Yeah,
so,
sure.
So yeah, because it is incredibly unusual for an archbishop to become an auxiliary bishop, you know, but he retains the title because the Pope gave him the title. You know,
yeah, of course.
No, that's beautiful. We're blessed to have him.
And certainly because of all of his experience, he brings such a wealth of experience and knowledge from all these different places that he's been. And through it all, though, he's kept that same spirit that I saw early on in him, you know, good with people and being a prayerful man and being able to enjoy life. So...
Yeah, I've only ever met him briefly. I was up north at the official welcome, but yeah, he seemed like just a very, very kind man, very sincere, very kind, and easy to talk to.
Yes, and I think you'll find him be a very worthwhile interviewee for you.
Absolutely, we'll have to get him on here. I'm sure he could tell some pretty wild stories from his time, you know, in different assignments, and we'll ask him about camp too.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You know, it's been really an honor, a pleasure having you here, Bishop. We ask this to everyone, but especially as a vocations director, do you have any, like, advice for young men who are discerning a call, things that they should do if maybe they're thinking about it but on the fence, things they should do, things they should not do? What would be your words to a young man listening to this who is maybe toyed with the idea or considering the idea of the priesthood?
First thing I would say is that most often used phrase from the Bible, you know, be not afraid, that's repeated so many times throughout the scriptures. If God wants you to do something with your life, it's going to be good. Doesn't mean it's going to be easy, but it's going to be good. It's going to give them a kind of fulfillment that they can't experience anywhere else, you know. Whatever it is that God's asking them to do. So don't be afraid. I often compared discernment for a religious vocation to being like dating. When you're dating a person, you want to get to know everything about them, to get to know their values, get to know their family, everything you can possibly know before, you know, making that choice, which is also a discernment, of course. But discerning the priesthood is similar. You know, you need to find out everything you can about the priesthood. You know, bug your parish priest. Ask him lots of questions.
That's right.
You know, I think Father Craig has got some discernment groups that get together and meet.
Mm-hmm.
And this is like-minded people who are all, you know, wrestling with the same kind of questions. And to do that in a community setting is you know, a wonderful gift as well. Certainly to spend time with the Blessed Sacrament, to get to Mass regularly. Those are, you know, those, and plus your own personal prayer life are very, very important as you go through that whole discernment process. But don't be afraid.
Be not afraid. Yes. Yeah. Beautiful words from the scripture. Usually I ask this at the beginning, or usually Father Craig asks it at the beginning. I'm a bit of a rookie here at doing this. But oftentimes we'll just share a blessing that we've had from the past month. Is there any particular blessing you've had recently that you'd like to share with our listeners today?
I guess it would just be the blessing, you know, we had just last week of the massive welcome for Archbishop Russell. It was such a joyous occasion, and for a couple reasons. One was, seemed like it was the first time we could have a big choir in the cathedral, to have people there too to celebrate. So, and then of course the personal side, being able to welcome this good friend of mine, and to be able to know that I'll be ministering, you know, with him over these next years was a great blessing, a great joy.
Absolutely, that is a blessing. I think my blessing would also be similar in that. Kind of rekindling old friendships when I was up at camp for the week, and rekindling some of the friendships I'd had both with campers and former counselors who now work there in director positions. It was so beautiful to be back, and it's a place that gives me a lot of life when I visit. So.
Indeed. Good.
Well, Bishop, thank you so much for joining us today. This was a great pleasure to welcome you here. As we wrap up, again, Father Craig was unable to join us. He's a little under the weather today, so offer a quick prayer for his speedy recovery. If you're wondering where I was last month, the offer I couldn't refuse came from my dad, and it was to get away for a couple-day fishing trip with him. So
wonderful.
That was a beautiful opportunity. It was a tradition we'd had every year, but hadn't been able to make it for the last 9 years. So resurrected an old tradition.
Beautiful.
With that, Bishop, would you like to close us in prayer?
I'd be happy to. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen.
Good and gracious God, as we bring this podcast to a close, we know that many are listening who are trying to listen to your voice, trying to hear your voice in the midst of a very noisy culture. Lord, we pray that you inspire them, touch their hearts in a way that they know truly it is you that's knocking on the door of their hearts. Help them not to be dissuaded by earthly things, earthly temptations, but to trust that you will lead them where they need to go, where you want them to be in order to continue building up your church in this world. We thank you for the ministry of the Vocation Office of Father Craig and Father David. We thank you for all who make the efforts to not only pray for vocations, but also who are unafraid to invite young people to pray about their vocation. Lord, bless us all and everything that you call us to do. Help us to never be afraid and trust that you're at our side each and every day. And we ask these and all of our prayers in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. You've been listening to Men of the Hearts, a monthly podcast from the Archdiocese of Detroit Office of Priestly Vocations. Join me, your host, Father David Pellican, and usually our host, Father Craig Gira, as we explore the priesthood, hear vocation stories from priests all over the Archdiocese, and answer questions about discerning a priestly vocation. Tune in every month to wherever you get your podcasts. Learn more at DetroitPriestlyVocations.com.